Hello everyone, greetings. Welcome back to the CMS Durability Test webinar series brought to you by Mobility Outlook. This is the third webinar in this series, and I'm sure all of you have benefited immensely from the first two masterclasses. In the first webinar, the focus was on an introduction to durability testing, and the second masterclass looked at road load data acquisition. The masterclass today is on load and fatigue analysis. As in the first two sessions, the session today will be led by Gert Frans. He's a business development manager for data analytics and durability at Siemens Digital Industries Software based in Leuven, Belgium. His areas of expertise include mobile data acquisition systems for the automotive and transportation industry, from optical measurement systems to inline robotic laser scanning and load data processing for durability testing. Gert Frans also holds a Bachelor of Science degree in Industrial Sciences from Groepte, Leuven, Belgium. We will have the final two masterclasses next week, that is on August 10th and 12th. So do not miss tuning in to those sessions as well. At this stage, I must also remind all of you to participate in this session actively by asking questions to our expert. Please do remember to post your questions only in the Q&A panel provided at the bottom of your screens to ensure we do not miss out on your questions. Thank you, welcome, and over to you, Gert.
Thank you very much. Let me share my screen. There you go, you should see a blue screen and okay, you see my screen currently?
Yes, Gert.
Let me also stop the video. Yeah, okay. Good, so also from my side, welcome again to this third session of the durability testing webinar series. Now, before I start, and for those of you who follow a little bit the Olympic Games, congratulations for your bronze medal, which you achieved yesterday. Actually, by accident, I stumbled upon the game between the Indian hockey team and the German hockey team. It was the game for the silver, sorry, for the bronze medal. And when I start watching, the German team was leading with 3-1. And what happened then was actually a very amazing game where India came back and even won with 5-4. So congratulations to the Indian hockey team. Good. So as introduced today, the session of today will be on the load and fatigue analysis. For those of you who followed the session on Monday, they will recognize this slide. So here I explain the different activities of a typical durability test campaign. Without going into details, it goes from test preparation over to instrumentation, test setup, measure, validate, and then in the office, the analysis part, reporting, sharing, and test schedule creation. So the session on Wednesday, we ended with validating the data after the measurement. So now the next step is to further analyze the data and make a report out of it. Good. So before you actually, or the test engineer can actually do an in-depth durability analysis of the data first needs to be consolidated. Yeah? So what are the typical challenges when you want to consolidate the test data? So first of all, what we see with a lot of customers is that they still do this consolidation in a manual way. They do it channel by channel. We see still, unfortunately, a lot of them use, for example, Excel to do that. So this can be very time consuming and also very sensitive to human interpretation and errors. So maybe one anomaly in the data can be for one engineer not an anomaly, but for the other engineer it potentially can be. Secondly, or a second challenge that we see is that also, unfortunately, still a lot of customers, they need to, in order to process the data, they need to export the data from the acquisition software and upload it into another tool or software to process the data. And so that takes quite some time. And last, also what we see is that in case the customer is capable of processing the data in an automatic way by using a predefined process in the processing software, that this process still needs to be validated if it's okay or not. So they create a process from scratch. Then in order to know if that process is okay, yes or no, they need to run the process with the selected data, look at the data, and then decide, is my process complete, yes or no? And is it working as I expected to work? Yeah? So this is or can be an iterative process with which the test engineer can lose a lot of time. Good. First poll, which I would like to ask you is, do you use the same software to acquire the data and also to process the data? And the answer is very simple, yes or no. So I give you a couple of seconds. So the question is really, do you either use a dedicated software for the acquisition and a dedicated software for the processing, or do you use a single software platform which can do both? A couple more seconds. Yeah, as I actually already expected, there are still, unfortunately, a lot of customers who still use a different software for acquisition and processing. So with this, they do not only lose time when converting the data from the acquisition to the processing time, but they need to buy two different software. And also they need to train their people to be able to use those two different software. And so there are a couple of disadvantages. Good. So what do I mean with data consolidation? So basically, data consolidation is the process to go from the raw measured data to clean consolidated raw data. And this basically means that you look in the raw data for any signal failures, artifact identification, or specific spikes due to a sensor failure. Sometimes it's possible that there is a drift in the measured data or an offset. Maybe the test engineer on the proving line forgot to balance the sensor before doing the actual measurement. We've seen cases where the test engineer has made a mistake during the setup in defining the units or the name to a specific channel. So potentially this also needs to be corrected afterwards. And also sometimes time series need to be either decomposed or split it into time series or sometimes even merged. So what you will see in the SimCenter Test Lab software, that data consolidation can actually be done either interactively, and I'll show you in a short demo, or by creating or running an automated process. And thanks to this, we can secure our customers. We can secure to our customers that they can get the best high-grade, consolidated, and accurate road load data. Good, let me stop the presentation and show you in a small demo how in the SimCenter Test Lab Neo software, how can you consolidate the data. So I will start from the data from Wednesday, where we ended. So we checked the data on the predefined test procedure. And the remaining good runs were these four. So we had three runs on the Belgian block and one on the Salto. So this is the data that I'm going to check for any anomalies. I'm going to put them in the input basket. And then I go to the process view inside the test lab software. Now, first of all, the way that you, and you already saw a preview on Wednesday, the way that you create a process in the TestLab software is in a very visual, graphical way. So you don't need to know any programming language to create a process. So you just connect blocks, or like we call it, method blocks. So it starts with your input data. So first of all, I forgot one thing, is namely to show in the data what is potentially wrong. So I go back to this and let me first, I've created a view where I only show my wheel force transducers, specifically the one in front left and front right, and all the forces and the moments of the torques. So here again, you see the power of the pivot table and the preview picture, what I showed you on Wednesday. So with one click, you can immediately see the results which are displayed here on the right. Let me overlap the graphs. So here I see the time series, and at the top I see some of the statistics. So this looks from the first sight pretty okay. So I can scroll through the different data, and here I see a problem. So here in one of the runs there is a spike, and more specifically, if I look at the range over here, so you see there is one outliner from the second run, which shows a very big range. So this is something that I need to correct in the wheel force transducers channels. In the second view, which I created, is a view where I only show the accelerometer, the measured accelerometers. So the accelerometers, which are mounted on the body, front, left, front, right, and also on the steering column. So also here, I can scroll through the data. So here immediately also, I see that there is already some of the runs which show an offset. So this has an offset compared to the other measurements. And when I scroll through the data, then basically I see here there is a mean value of 1.9, where the other shows a value around zero. So this is also something which I need to correct in my data. Good. So these are already two things that I know. So I can already start creating a process. So I start from my input block. First, I'm going to split the data. And the one that's coming out of the green triangle here is all my wheel force transducers channels. So I select the group of wheel force transducers. So the data coming out of the green triangle will be only the wheel force transducers channels. And here I'm going to do a spike filter like that. So when clicking on the method here on the right, you can define some or fine tune the parameters. Then I would like to process the accelerometer or acceleration channels. So here again, everything else than the wheel force transducers, I'm going to put in this split method. And here I'm going to filter on the measured quantity. And in this case, I'm going to select the acceleration channels. And here I'm going to do a mean removal. Good. So this is something which I already know upfront. So I need to do a correction on the wheel force transducers and also on the accelerometers. But then I don't know anymore what I would like to correct. I don't know if there is something else wrong in the data. So at this point, I actually need to go into the data again, view data, and then scroll through the remaining channels. And then if I see something wrong, then I need to come back to my process. I need to add these blocks and so on. But in TestLab, there is a simpler way. So first of all, I'm going to define that I'm only would like to look at the displacement, the force, and the strain channels like that. And then I'm going to add after this a method block which is called interactive analysis. What does it do? Well, I will show you. So when I double click on this method, you will see that actually TestLab starts to execute all the different methods until it comes up to the moment of this interactive analysis block, and it will show me the channels which he has processed so far. So let me go to the active analysis part. So here we have the remaining channels, the ones that I've selected. So now I can scroll through these channels and look if there are some other anomalies or things which I would like to correct. One thing, for example, to give you an easy example. So here there are two channels on the tie rods, which have an output in the plus X direction. So here I remember I made a mistake. This should not be plus X, but this should be an output in the plus Y. So I've selected these two channels. And here on the right, I have an interactive analysis view or so-called pane. So here, from here, I can also select some of the methods. And here I would like to edit the metadata. So I select the metadata editing. And I'm going to change the plus X into the plus Y, like that. I click OK. And you will see that immediately he has adapted it to the correction which I've done. So we've changed it to the plus Y. Another thing that I would like to correct, and it's maybe not really realistic, but imagine there is something wrong with this big spikes over here. So I'm going to zoom in a little bit. So this I would like to move out remove from my time series. So I'm going to select this area, and then I'm going to start a method called time data editing. And I'm going to say I'm going to interpolate this, remove it and interpolate the remaining part. So I click OK. And you will see that he actually has interpolated the remaining part. If I would like to compare with the original curve, that's very easy. I just click show original curve, and the gray curve over here shows me the curve before I applied the time data editing. Good. Zoom out again. And OK, imagine this is everything that I wanted to correct. So I click the return button like that. And I come back to my process. So now if I double click on the interactive analysis again, like that, you will actually see that Tesla has recorded all the manual processing steps that I've done before. So I've selected my two tie rod channels and I did the metadata editing. I selected again the tie rod channels and I did the time data editing, where I selected the part and did the interpolation. If needed, I can further fine-tune these parameters. So for example, I made a mistake and I would like to make the section a little bit wider. So I do 8.5 to 9.5 seconds, like that. I go back to the main process. And now I can, if I go back to the data, there is still a little issue which I saw in the software I need to look into a little bit closer. Like that. For some reason, he unselected my data. Like that. There is also a little delay which I need to look into. Yeah, and then I run my data. So when I go back to the active analysis, he will start processing the data. Data is coming in, the four runs. And when he's finished, takes a little bit longer than I expected. But I go back to my Wheel4Sense users view. So when I'm now scroll, let me remove these sections. When I go back to the one there was a spike, you see that the spike is removed. When I go up to the acceleration views, there was an offset. So also here you see the offset has been removed. And when I go up to the tie rod channels, which were over here, you see that the direction is changed to the plus Y direction. And when I go to the actual time series, you see here the removed part and the interpolation. So this, as you can see, saves you quite some time in creating the process, where with other software, you first need to, in an iterative way, need to create your process. You create your process, run it, look at the data, go back to the process, add the things that you need to add, and this multiple times. So here with Tesla, you can do that from one single step. Good. Go back to the presentation. Good. So I've validated the data. I've cleaned up the data, removed all spikes, offsets, and so on. So now I can further do an in-depth durability analysis of my data. Now, before I show you how you can do that in the software, I would first like to give you a little bit of a theory background on how you can get durability insights on the acquired loads. Good, is there a way to? No. So imagine you would like to, you have done two measurements. You have done a measurement A, which you see here on the left, and you've done a measurement B, which you see on the right. And the difference that you see over here is here the amplitude, right? It's a very simple measurement. It's a clean sinusoidal signal, where the range over here is going from minus 30 to 30. The mean stress is about zero. And here the amplitude is smaller, and also the mean stress is a little bit higher. So if I would like to ask you to compare these two measurements, and that's the next poll, which of the two measurements do you think, based on your experience, which of the two measurements has the highest damage potential? When I would apply this time signal to a specific component or to the vehicle, which according to you will cause the highest damage? Is it measurement A, the one on the left, or is it measurement B? Yeah. Ah, okay, that's surprising me. So the most people think that B, so the one on the right, has the biggest damage. If I would need to answer this, I would assume that the one on the left would have the biggest damage. Why? You have a bigger range or bigger amplitude than the one on the right. Okay, the mean stress is also a little bit different, but my first guess would be that measurement A would be would have a higher damage potential. Yeah? So if you look here in this case for those two specific measurements, the comparison is rather simpler. But if I need to ask you to compare these two measurements, and you have a measurement which is done on road A with the time series looking like that, and then a measurement done on road B with a time series like that, I will not ask you the questions, but I think the answer, or it would be very hard for you to decide just based on the time series, which of the two measurements has the highest damage potential. Yeah. So in order to facilitate that, the way to give an answer to that is to go from the time domain to the damage domain. Good. So how do I go to the damage domain? How do I calculate damage? How do I know the fatigue lifetime of a component? Yeah. For those of you who followed this session on Monday, they remember or should remember there are three factors which have an influence on the damage or the fatigue lifetime of your component, which are the loads, the geometry, and the material. Yeah. Now, in order to go from these, in order to calculate the damage, there are a couple of things that you need to do. So first of all, the first thing that you need to do is you need to go from this real measured complex signal to a series of simplified cyclic loadings, which have a specific range or amplitude, a specific mean stress, and a specific repetition factor. And this can be done with a method called ring flow counting. Now, all of these simple reversal cyclic loadings with a specific range, they all cause a specific damage. And which specific damage can be looked up by using an Zen curve for constant amplitude loading. Yeah. So this curve is this is defined by the material that you use and also by the geometry. Now, due to the differences in geometry and material properties, it is possible that on specific locations of your components, you will have higher stress locations on so-called high spots. Yeah? This local stress concentration is defined by a stress concentration factor, KT, and this will adapt the local loads to compensate for the higher stress concentration. Good. And in the end, you need to sum up the results from the rainfall counter and the Zen curve to come to the damage, which is done by using a damage accumulation rule. Good. Now, in the next couple of slides, I will explain to you what is an Zen curve, what is rainfall counting, and what is the damage accumulation. So let me start by first explaining the what is an erzenker. And to explain this, I would like to do a little experiment by using these big paper clips, also called jumbo paper clips. And I'm pretty sure that some of you have done this in the past. I imagine you are following a meeting offline via Zoom or Teams, and the meeting is not so interesting, so you start to do things with your hands. So for example, you take a paperclip and you start bending this paperclip up and down. No? And that's actually the experiment that I would like to do. So you take one of the legs of the paperclips and you bend it, first of all, from the zero angle to an upwards 10 degree angles, back down to a minus 10 degrees angle, and back to zero. Yeah? So you're basically going to apply a fully reversal loading. You go from tensile stress to compressive stress. And this you're going to repeat until the leg breaks off. So after a certain moment, probably it will break over here. So this you're going to repeat for several angles. An angle of 20 degrees, an angle of 45 degrees, and an angle of 90 degrees. And then after this experiment, you're going to write down in a table how many times that you need it for every angle to break the leg of the paper. So when I've done this experiment myself, this is the result. So for an angle of 10 degrees, I needed almost 80 times to break off the leg. For 10 degrees, almost 30 times, 45, 7 times, and 90 degrees, it was almost after one cycle that I broke off this leg. Now, if you put this table into a graph, then this would look like this. So here I've plotted the angle on the vertical axis, and on the horizontal axis, I've put the number of cycles to failure. And I did that in a logarithmic way. Now, basically what you see over here, that is actually what we call the SN curve, also called the Wöhler diagram. Wöhler, if you remember from Monday, this is the German engineer who all started this damage and fatigue investigation. So the S stands for the stress. In this example, the stress is proportional to the actual angle under which we bent the paperclip. And the N stands for the number of cycles to failure. Yeah. Now, something very interesting that you see here in this graph is the logarithmic nature of fatigue. So let me explain what I mean by that. So if you look at the test where I bended one of the legs of the paperclip under an angle of 45 degrees. So the number of cycles that I needed was 7 times. So that's this point on the graph. Now, if I halve the number of, if I halve the angle under which I bent the leg, yeah, so that was the 20 degrees angle, then actually I see I do not have the double of number of cycles, but I have 4 times the number of cycles before this leg breaks off. So that is what we call the logarithmic nature of fatigue, going from 2 to a factor of 4. Good. So here on this slide, you see an example of what could be a real SN curve for a specific material. In this case, it's steel. Yeah? So the vertical axis represents the stress amplitude, S, and the horizontal axis represents the number of cycles to fatigue. So this curve you can use to look up if you have a specific stress amplitude S1, how many cycles do I need to break my component. This curve has specific characteristics. So a first thing that you see here is the stress that you see at the top left over here. Yeah? And this is what we call the ultimate tensile stress limit, called SUT. So this is the stress amplitude that you need in order to break your component after one cycle, with one cycle. The line over here, where the curve flattens, where the curve is horizontal, is what we call the endurance limit, or also called fatigue strength. So this is the maximum stress amplitude that you can apply to your components without breaking your component. So all stresses or loads below this curve will never break your components. So this is typically with never break, this is typically starting from 1 billion number of signs. Now, this is theoretically in practice, if for imagine you have, for example, a garage door which has a spring to facilitate the opening. This garage door you maybe use 4 times a day for 30 years, so you will never get to this 1 million. But if you if this garage door survives for 30 years or 40 years, then you also would sign this as being infinite number of cycles. Typically, this endurance limit is the half of the ultimate stress limit for steel, and for aluminum is about 40%. Good. Another thing that we see here on this SN curve is this point, where on the negative slope of the curve, this is what we call the yield strength. So this is the point where the component goes from the elastic behavior from this part into the plastic behavior of these of the component. So basically, the curve consists out of two parts. The part here on the right is what we call the infinite life part. So this is the part where if the stresses are within the blue area over here, your component will never break. And then the part on the left is what we call the finite life. So if your stress or if your load is within the light blue part, then there is a moment where at a certain moment your components will break. This part, the finite life, can be divided into two other sections. So the one on the right is what we call the high cycle fatigue. So you have a high number of cycles going from 10,000 to 1 million. This is also the part where the component behaves in an elastic manner. So this means that basically if you stop applying these loads to your component comes back to its original shape. And of course, then the other part is what we call the low cycle fatigue, going from one cycle to 10,000, sorry, over here. And this is what we call the plastic behavior. So this is where your loads, you typically have higher loads than the elastic behavior. So here your component starts to deform at a certain moment in time. Good. So that is what is an SN curve. Now, how do you create such an SN curve? So this is done by so-called Wöhler fatigue test. So again, our well-known engineer, August Wöhler, who started doing these or defining these type of tests. So basically, a Wöhler fatigue test is a test where you apply an alternating or sinusoidal load with a constant amplitude onto different material samples, and this for different cyclic load levels. So what does it mean? You start by a material sample. So this is an example of this particular steel. This sample is then mounted into a testing machine. It's so-called a coupon testing machine. And this machine will apply continuously a alternating tension compression to this material sample, what you see over here. So this is the load that is applied to this particular material sample. And this test goes on until, and this you see on the video, so there was a little crack start. At a certain moment, the component breaks. So the moment that the component breaks, the number of cycles, alternating sinus that is applied to this material is then written down into a graph, which is called the Wöhler curve. And this test is then repeated several times for different material samples. The minimum number of material samples that is taken is 3 samples. And this repeated for a minimum of 5 amplitude loads. So here you see much more loads. And this is when you then draw a curve through the different points, this is where the SN curve appears. Good. If you would like to know some more information, or if you need to look up the parameters of specific material, material SN curve, then I can advise you this book. This book is called the FKM Analytic Strength Assessment. There are several editions. This is the latest one. which is written by FKMM, which is the Forschungskuratorium Maschinenbau in Germany. So I said it contains not only the theory on Ezenker, so basically it's more detailed information than what I explained to you right now. And also you can actually look up the different material tables with the actual mechanical properties in order to construct the Ezenkers. Good, the logarithmic description between stress and cycles to failure, is actually discovered by an engineer, a French engineer called Basquin, which continued the work of August Wöhler. So this logarithmic nature of fatigue, what does it mean actually? That basically by changing slightly the cyclic load, so the magnitude of the cyclic load, applied to a specific steel component will actually have a big influence on the lifetime of this component. So if you take this example, imagine you have a specific load and you lower the load in this case with 13%, you will actually see that the number of cycles doubles. So by lowering the loads on your component, you can double the fatigue lifetime of your component. Now, how much this influenced your number of cycles is actually defined by the Basquin coefficient. So this is what you see over here. So this is the slope of your SN curve, of the elastic region. Yeah? So this is called Basquin coefficient or K factor. So if you have a big K factor, so if this is very large, then this will have a larger or bigger influence to your fatigue lifetime or number of cycles of your component. So the K factor is depending on the material that you use. So here you see a couple of examples. So for welds, you have a K factor of 3, steel is 5, aluminum of 7. So if you compare this between welds and aluminum, for example, you see that there is a factor of 3 difference between welds and aluminum because of this bigger K factor. And these are actually two very important things. So first of all, if you would like to design your component for durability and you would like to survive it as long as possible, you can either reduce your local load stresses, which indicated in the table over here, or you can change the material because this has an influence on the slope of your SN curve. Good. As I will show you later on during a demo in the SimCenter Test Lab software, you have a large extensive list of SN curves for different type of materials, as you can see on the left. If you select an SN curve in the list, you can change some of the parameters over here. As you can see over here, you can also define the slope of the elastic region. There is even the possibility to define two slopes. What I showed you up to now, so this type of curves is the most simple curve that you can have, but in some curves you see there is even a third slope, which is there is a little nick over here in the middle where you have so two K factors. Good, so that was all information that I would like to give you on SN curves. So the next thing that I would like to show you is or explain you is the rain flow counting method. Yeah. So this was invented by a Japanese engineer this time, Endo-san. So what is rain flow counting? It's actually a technique to decompose a spectrum of a varying, very complex stress series, what you can see on the left, into a set of simple stress reversals. So in this complex signal, you're basically going to look how many of a cyclic stress with this amplitude is present in this signal, how many of this test amplitude, how many stress loads of this. So how does it work? Now, there are a couple of preparation steps, which I will not explain during this webinar because this would lead us in too much detail. Now, one of the preparation steps that is done before showing this graph is actually where I simplify my time series, where I put the reversal points, so these points, into so-called bins, what you see over here. To keep it simple here, I've just defined 10 bins, but in reality, or in real time, real case, you typically have 100 or even more bins. Good. So the rainflow counting method is a four-point algorithm. So this means that you will go from your in your time series, you go from left to right, and you look for four consecutive points, which you see marked over here. And on these four points, you're basically gonna look for closed loops. Yeah? So when I take the first example, you will see that I go from this point, I go into a point into bin 8, down to a point in bin 7, up to bin 8, further to bin 10. So this is what we call a closed loop. I go from 8 to 7, back to 8. So this I'm going to put in a matrix, which you see on the right, contains a from load level and a to load level. And I'm going to count the number of times I have this closed loop. So I have this one time, so I mark one here in the from 8 to bin 7. And then I continue in my signal. The next closed loop that I find is this one. So I go from bin 4 to bin 3 and through bin 4 to bin 5. So that's the next closed loop that I have. And I write it into my matrix here on the right. So I go from bin 4 to bin 3 and back to bin 4. I didn't mention that over here, but once you find the closed loop, you're going to remove this closed loop. So you're going to close this point with this point and I remove the others. Yeah? So then the next closed loop that I have is this one, where I go from bin 2 to bin 5, back or through bin 2 to bin 1. And also here, I'm going to write this in my matrix here on the right. And actually, the matrix now that you see here, so the going with the from load level to the to load level, is what we call a rainflow matrix. Yeah? And this is how a real rainflow matrix looks like. So basically, you have here your from axis, your to axis, and the color of the dots represent the number of cycles. So the ones, the purple ones, is going up to 10,000 cycles, and the one with the yellow ones is going up to 90,000 number of times you have that specific from to load. So here on the left, in the from axis, you have your number of bins. As I said, here you go to even 100 bins. Now, on the opposite side, you have the respective real quantity. So in this case, we measured a displacement. So bin 8 corresponds with a displacement of minus 40 millimeters. Bin 72 corresponds, for example, to a displacement of 38 millimeters. And the same with the two axes over here. So here you have the bins, and on the opposite side, you have your displacement. Good. Now, as you can see, with a little bit of imagination, there are two diagonals you can draw through this rainflow. And the first diagonal that you can see is here what we call the zero mean diagonal. Zero mean diagonal means that all points which lie on this diagonal have a mean zero, mean. Yeah. So if I take a point which is, for example, more or less lying over here, so this is 38 millimeters, and this is minus 38 millimeters. So the mean stress of this is zero. Yeah? So this means that points lying on the left side of this diagonal is what we call compression. So they have a negative mean stress. If I take, for example, let's take this point, that's more or less minus 40, going up to something about minus 10. So this is a negative mean stress. Of course, then the points lying on the right side of the diagonal are my tension points. So these have a positive mean stress. For example, this point has plus 28 going to, I don't know, plus 30. So a positive mean stress. Another diagonal that I can draw over here is the zero range diagonal. So all points lying on this diagonal have a almost zero range or no amplitude. For example, a point over here is plus 28, and this is also more or less plus 28, so a zero amplitude. So this basically means that all points to the left and the right have a larger amplitude and therefore also a potential larger damage. The points on the right, to be complete, are what we call standing points. So this basically means that you go from a specific load or stress to higher stress and back to the lower stress. And therefore, the points on the left is what we call hanging points. So going from a specific stress to a lower stress and to a higher stress. If I take this point, for example, which is around, let's say, 40 millimeters, going to minus 38 and back to plus 40 millimeters. And that's also the reason that some engineer already can see, based on the shape of the rain flow, what is the damage potential of the measured signal. So typically, if you have a lot of points in these areas with large amplitudes, then this engineer knows that potentially there is a high damage in this signal. Good. So that was the information which I wanted to share you for the rain flow counting. So we know now how many loads we have with a specific amplitude and a specific mean stress, and how many times I have this. And I also know for a specific amplitude, how much damage this causes onto my compound. So how do I bring now these two data together? This I do with a damage accumulation rule, more specifically the Palmgren minor rule. So what does this rule does? So imagine, and to keep it very simple, I have a done a measurement where I have only three amplitudes inside. I have the red one, I have the green, and I have the blue one. Yeah? Now I've done my rain flow counting, and the result of the rain flow counting is that from the red cycle, I have this 500 times. I've counted 500 times. The green is 1,000 times, and the blue one is 10,000 times. Yeah. Now, the Palmgren minor rule says that failure will occur if the accumulated damage of all loads is equal to one. Yeah. And what is this accumulated damage? This is actually the sum of the relationship between the actual counted number of cycles divided by the maximum number of cycles. Yeah. So for our example, so I take my SN curve, and I start with the first amplitude, so which is the red one. So I divide the actual counted number of cycles, which is so this time 500 times, by the maximum number of cycles that I need to break the component. So when I look into the SN curve for the first stress, so this is the 10 to the third, so 1,500 divided by 1,000 is 0.5. For the green loads, this is 1,000 cycles, so this number over here, and then when I look it up in my SN curve, the maximum number of cycles to break the component is 0.01. Yeah. For the blue load, when I counted it, this was 10,000 times, so 10 to the fourth. But when I look it up in the SN curve, then actually this load lies below the endurance limit. So the number of cycles to break my component is unlimited. So that's why this quotient is equal to zero. When I count this up, sum this up, I have 0.51, which is lower than one. And therefore, these loads will not cause any damage to my component. Yeah. Good. So I explained to you what is a SN curve, what is rain flow counting, and how do I sum this all up by using the damage accumulation rule. Yeah? So this you can use to calculate the actual real damage or real fatigue lifetime of your component. Now, when we talk about test engineers who are doing tests on proving grounds on public roads, they're actually not so interested in the real damage or real fatigue lifetime of your components. What they are interested in is comparing measurements with each other. Yeah? If they do a measurement on road A or road B, they just would like to compare which has a higher damage than the other. Yeah? So if you, in that case, they are not so interested in the real damage, but they're actually that interested in what we call a pseudo damage. Yeah? So that's the damage not representing, let's say, the real exact damage, but it gives you a number which you can compare with other pseudo damages. Yeah? So in that case, we can simplify a couple of things. So first of all, the test engineer takes the real loads. So it's not an artificial created signal, but it takes the real loads. Since the material or even the geometry between two measurements on a road A, road B, or road C will not change, he can take a generic S-N curve with a specific defined slope K, defined K factor. Yeah? So he does not really need to look up the real S-N curve, but he can take an S-N curve which more or less corresponds with your material or geometry. Since the geometry is not always, at least from a test point of view, is not always available or known, and also the geometry in most cases will not really change between two measurements, we can simply exclude the stress concentration factor by putting it equal to one. So we put it out from the equation. Good. So I've explained to you what is rain flow. So just based on the rain flow, I said some engineers are capable of based on the shape of the rain flow, define what is the amount of damage. But there is an easier way, and that's by using what we call a range pair diagram. And that's what I would like to explain you on this slide. So how do I create a range pair diagram? So I start from a simple rain flow, which I explained to you on the previous slides. Now, as also explained to you, is that all points which are lying to the left of the zero range diagonal, so the hanging signals, if the points are now hanging, going from a specific stress to a lower stress and up or the inverse, that has not really an influence on your damage. Yeah? So that does not influence the fatigue lifetime of your components. So to simplify things, I'm going to project all points to the left of my zero range diagonal and going to project it to the right. Yeah? So this is what we call folding. I'm going to project all points to the left and project it to the right. So we have still these points. As explained on the previous slide, so the points here going from bottom right to top left, the mean stress changes, and the points going from the middle to the upper or the top right points, there the amplitude grows. So this is the range, let's say. So basically, if I take this rain flow and rotate it, yeah, we have here on the vertical axis my range. Yeah? So this is this over here. And on the horizontal axis, I have my mean stress. So I have this rain flow. This is what we call a range mean rain flow. This is, if you look at the US, for example, a lot of test engineers use the range mean rain flow. In Germany, they'll use a lot of the symmetric rain flow. Good. So we have points going growing in range, points changing in mean stress. And then the color of the dots gives me the number of cycles. Now, when you just compare measurements with each other, it is allowed to ignore the mean stress. Eh? So you can ignore if there is a tension or compression. Eh? You can imagine if you drive with a vehicle with a specific load and with a specific number of people aboard, if you now do that on road A, on road B, the pre-compression that you have, for example, on your springs of your suspension will not change between road A and road B. There is always a pre-compression. Yeah? So that's why in purely to do simple comparisons, you can ignore the mean stress component of these two, three parameters. So we go here from this range mean rain flow to a what we call a range pair diagram. So here we have two parameters only. So we have the range, which we keep, and the number of cycles. So the color of the dots over here is here the horizontal axis. Yeah. So what we here can see over here from the points or the loads with a high range, we only have a number of cycles. You have not a lot of cycles. And the low amplitude ranges, there we have a lot of cycles. Good. Ignoring the mean stress, that's something where I come back to in the next slides. So I have my range, I have my number of cycles. So now I take the S-N curve into account to convert from cycle count to damage. Yeah? So here you see I have a range pair diagram where I express range in damage or pseudo damage, depending on the Zen curve that you use. So for the high load amplitudes, I have a high damage. For the lower, if you go down, for the lower ranges, I have low damage. And then the last step that I do is where I'm going to accumulate all the different damage to each other. So I'm going to take, for example, this amplitude, I'm going to add it to the previous amplitude. So I'm going to add up all the different amplitudes. This is basically applying the damage accumulation rule. And then my graph looks like that. So this, as you can see, this gives me a nice graph, which I can use to compare different, in a very visual way, compare different measurements with each other. Yeah. The bigger that graph, I have a nice visual in the next couple of slides, where you can compare different range pair diagrams with each other. Good. Let's see what time is it. I still do have a couple of minutes. So let me, this is extra information, gets maybe a little bit more complicated than the previous slides. But I would like to elaborate a little bit more on the mean stress influence on Zen curves. As explained on the previous slides, for just doing simple comparisons between a measurement on road A, road B, and so on, you can simply remove the mean stress influence. But of course, that doesn't mean that there is an influence. If you really would like to know the exact damage or the influence of the mean stress, then you need to take this mean stress into account. So first of all, what is mean stress? That's very simple. If you have a simple stress or time series, which you see over here, then of course the mean stress is the sum of the max and the min divided by two. No? And if you look at the Zen curves, then the mean stress is actually equal to zero. So all the Zen curves that you find in the FTM book, which I explained to you on the previous slides, these Zen curves are constructed for a fully reverse loading, or with other words, where the mean stress is equal to zero. Now, in real life, of course, this is not the case, or barely the case. There we have cases where you have a mean stress different from zero. And we have two different cases. One case where the mean stress is bigger than zero. So this is the case where you have tension. And the case where the mean stress is negative. So that's the case where we have a compression, what we call compression. If you have a cylinder, you have forces pushing compressing that specific cylinder or component. Now, as you can understand, and also as explained on Monday, when you talk about damage and fatigue, you talk about the start of cracks. So I think you can understand in case of tension, when you have a crack, then this tension will facilitate or will accelerate the growth of those micro cracks. Where with compression, if you have a crack, then compression will actually slow down that the growth of those micro cracks. So basically, this means that in case of tension, this will decrease or lower your Zen curve. So this will decrease your life. It will accelerate the failure or the growth of your crack. And when you have compression, this will increase the fatigue lifetime of your component, because it will close actually your micro cracks. So this you can clearly see here on the graph. If you take the same alternating stress or stress amplitudes, which you see over here, then compared to a fully reversed loading, where the mean stress is equal to zero, in case of tension, the number of cycles is lower than the number of cycles which you have for a mean stress equal to zero, and even less than the number of cycles that you need for in case of a compression. So conclusion, tension, mean stresses will reduce the fatigue life from that what is observed from a completely fully reverse loading where the mean stress is equal to zero. Good, so that's what you see here on the graph. So if you have a tension mean stress, where the mean stress is positive, this will lower your Zen curve. Yeah? You need to compensate for that. Now, another thing that you actually see here, that for a specific number of cycles, if let's take the N1 over here, you will actually see that there is a valid for a different set of combinations of alternating stresses with mean stresses. So basically you see that the number of cycles, this is valid for a combination of SA0, alternating stress of 0, with SM0, so mean stress 0, but the same number of cycles for combination of SA1 with SM1 and SA2 with SM2. And that's actually very interesting, because if you put that combinations into a graph, we have what we call a constant life diagram. So this this line, for example, represents all points which have the same fatigue lifetime. So this actually shows all possible combinations of alternating stress with mean stress for a specific number of cycles N1. Good. Now, this constant life diagram is actually used as a basis or for a model to compensate for tensile mean stress effects on high cycle fatigue spectrum. And this is what we call the Goodman line. And the Goodman line is actually a line which combines two points. It combines a point which is lying over here on the vertical axis. And this is the point where my alternating stress is equal to the endurance limit. So that's the maximum stress that you can apply without breaking your component. And a mean stress equal to 0. So this is a fully reverse loading. And the other point that is connecting this line is my point on the mean stress. That's the point where the mean stress is equal to my ultimate tensile strength. So that's the maximum stress that you can apply on your component to break it with one cycle. And that, but of course, that is where the alternating stress is equal to 0 in that case. Good. So again, this line contains all points which have the same fatigue lifetime, same number of cycles to break your component. So basically, you can use this Goodman line. So if you have a specific load with a stress or alternating stress SA1 and a mean stress of F1, to find the corresponding alternating stress where the mean stress is equal to 0. Yeah? So if you remember the step 3 of one of the previous slides, and let me rotate this mirror it, then I said that you can simply remove this point. But if you want to do it correct, then basically you can use, or if you have this point, if you want to correct it for the mean stress effect, you can use that Goodman line along the same Goodman line to find the corresponding point where with a specific alternating stress where the mean stress is equal to 0. Good. Now, this Goodman line, the one that I show you over here, that was the initial version. Over time, there were other engineers who further worked on that. I've got one thing to tell you. So basically, all points which lie below the Goodman line, those points lie in the infinite lifetime. So once you design your component for fatigue lifetime, you need to make sure that your point lies below the Goodman line. If it lies outside the line, then these points belong to the finite life. So if your point lies in the yellow area, then this means at a certain number of cycles, your component will break. Good. Now, over time, the Goodman line was further fine-tuned or optimized. So at a specific moment, there was an engineer, Soderberg, who said, yeah, but wait a minute. I also would like to avoid that that I go with my component from the elastic to the plastic region. I want to stay in my elastic region behavior of my components. Yeah? So that's why he said, yeah, now let's say the maximum mean stress that I allow is my yield strength. So that's this line over here. And this is also, so this is valid for tension, where the mean stress is positive. But they say, okay, let's also apply this for the cases where the mean stress is negative. So for the compression part. They also assumed in the first version, as also explained in the previous slide, compression has a, let's say, positive effect, but in a conservative way, they said, let's say, okay, when we have compression, there is actually no effect. So my alternating stress, if it changes, if the mean stress changes, there is actually no effect on the alternating stress. So that's this horizontal line. So the region that is marked now, which you see here in light blue, is actually what we call the safe region for yield and fatigue. So if you design your component and you see that the loads that this specific component or local notches on your component see, if this lies within the blue area, then you're safe for fatigue and yield. Your component will not break and it will also not deform. It will not go from the elastic into the plastic region. So this is designing for infinite life. To be complete, there were over time further optimizations of this curve, so which you see over here. So here, for example, you also see that they said, okay, in case of compression, let's give a positive effect on your infinite lifetime. But I will not go into detail during this session. Good. So if you would like to compare two different loads with each other, the key to success is to go from time domain to damage domain, calculate rain flow, use the SN curve, create a range pair diagram, and you can then simply compare two measurements with each other. Here you clearly see that the red measurement is more damaging than the other. Good. I will skip a couple of slides. I see I'm talking too much, but I will keep the slides in the presentation. Good. All the theory which I explained to you up till now is theory which I got from this book. If you're really in the mood, if you would like to have some more detailed information, I would like to go to this book. It's called Fatigue Testing and Analysis. By the way, the engineer here, Jung Lee Lee, is an ex-LMS or ex-Siemens employee who also participated in writing this book. Good. A lot of theory, a lot of maybe boring information, so maybe a small fun poll. Are you still awake? Two simple answers, yes or no. I know it's a lot of theory, but again, during these webinars, we have a mixed audience, people who have, of course, a lot of experience, but also people have no or limited information. That's why I included this theory. And it's also theory that you need to further understand the remaining of the slides. So good. That's very good to see that most people are still awake. I wonder the people who answered no, if they are asleep. I don't know how they could answer, but yeah, anyway. Good. Thank you. Thank you for answering, by the way. Good. So after this all theory, I would like to give you some more applications now. So when you talk about processing the data, doing in-depth durability analysis on your data, there are a lot of challenges, and some of the challenges are the ones that you also saw during the data consolidation. And so it takes a lot of time, especially when you do the analysis manually. You need to extra convert and upload data into other tools. A lot of customers do not use the same software. You challenge to perform your data analysis in a data-driven way instead of a process-driven way. We also see a lot of customers who say, yeah, look, TestLab is very nice, but yeah, I already have in the past created quite some processing scripts, which are not made, of course, in TestLab, but in other programs like MATLAB and Python. How do I need to throw them away? Can I reuse them? Yes or no? And in some cases, we also saw during one of the polls in the previous sessions, they said, yeah, I do not only, my team does not only do durability, but I also do NVH testing. So does this mean I need to use another software tool? Yes or no? Some people use another hardware, but software from us. So how do I import or export data? And also, not all, sometimes you have less experienced users, and of course they would not want to use an difficult to use software. So TestLab offers you a complete tool set with which you can do an in-depth durability, load data analysis and synthesis. It allows you to expand to other applications like NVH, for example. You have an external file access for both import and export. The list you see here is first a very small subset of data formats. As I showed you, you can do this analysis on the fly interactively, but also automated. As I will show you and already showed you before, there's a graphical user interface, so no need to know any programming language. All methods that are used in the TestLab software are compliant with most important standards, SAE, the American one, AFNOR, the French, and the DIN, the international standards. And all this technology and all methods that you have in the TestLab software is something which we have co-developed and also validated with one of the leading automotive OEMs in the world. So in the end, you can use SimCenter, TestLab, Neo to get more out of your data. Good, a couple of demos, two demos. The first demo is where I'm gonna show you how, I'm gonna take my data which I have consolidated, so it's cleaned up. So my four runs, I'm gonna put them in my input baskets. I'm gonna switch to my load data analysis section where I visualize the process. So this is how my process looks like. So first of all, I'm gonna only look at my wheel force transducers where I'm gonna calculate the damage potential. As you can see, I do the split of the DEMA, do a rain flow calculation. Based on the rain flow, I create a range pair but expressed in cycle count. And then I do a range pair but expressed in damage. So as I explained on the previous slides, to do that, I need an SN curve. So here you see the extensive list of SN curve. If you scroll through it, you see here a visual representation of that SN curve. And on the right, you have the parameters, which you can, if needed, fine tune to your needs. You can create your own SN curve, as you can see over here. There are customers who, instead of using SN curves for a specific material sample, who create an SN curve for a complete component, which is more representative, more realistic. But of course, then this means that they need to do this test and of course destroy several components of their vehicle. But this is also something which you can add into this list. Based on the rain flow, I also calculated my pseudo damage. Also here, I need to use a SN curve and I can select which damage method. A second block of calculation that I do is what I do on my displacement channels. I do a rain flow calculation, and based on the rain flow, I do a level crossing. That's also some kind of counting method. I do not have the time to do or explain this in this session. And time level, that's also another counting method based on the pure time series. Then I do a frequency content check on my acceleration channels. So basically I calculate the PSD. Here you see that I have the possibility to integrate existing third-party processing scripts. So here I have a MATLAB method block where I can paste this MATLAB script into the method. And for some reason, it's on my other screen over here. So here you see the MATLAB scripting pasted into this block. I have another small program which sends me an email with some extra information. So even without, if you don't have MATLAB, don't Python, there is still this block which you can use to add your specific methods. So I go back to my view data. Yeah, it asks me, so here to send me an email. I do not want an email. and wait until the processing is done. Let's enlarge a little bit the pivot table. Good, and again, here you see the power of my pivot table and preview picture. So I just click on one cell and it shows me the results here on the right, which is my calculated damage, rainflow, range pair, and so on. So with one click for one specific channel, here you see the four rainflows. Here you see my range pair expressed in cycles, range pair expressed in damage. And here you clearly immediately see that the blue run has the most damage, which is this run over here. And here at the bottom, I have my calculated pseudo damage. So like this, I can simply scroll through different channels and immediately see the results. So this was the level crossing and time at level for my acceleration channels. Yeah. And the displacement channels I have here, sorry, it's the other way around. So the displacement over here and here the acceleration. Here you see the PSD and another thing that you see, for example, here I see some strange phenomena. So you can add here, for example, harmonic cursor to see what's at which frequency that is. Apparently it's around 50 Hertz. So I can further start to investigate. Good, I will accept this. Another demo, small demo that I, let's see how much time do I have. No, I'm gonna skip that. There was another demo which I wanted to show you, but I'm not gonna show it, I don't have enough time. I will keep it in the presentation. So this is, I will just show you the results. So here I've processed my data to calculate the stress life. So here I did the calculation of the real fatigue lifetime of my component. And so I did that for four strain channels. And here, the results that you see is basically this here. So the result that I've calculated is for this point. So this is what we call the design point. And this is basically the maximum stress amplitude that I have for my range pair. So in my graph here on the right, the red curve is my range pair diagram. The green is my SN curve. So I see the blue, the design point of that specific channel is below the endurance limit. So I know there is this load I can apply without breaking my infinitely, without breaking my component. And the purple line is actually an extra one. It's what we call the design curve. So this means if I would shift up my design point along this curve, then I see at which point my component start to break. So that's where this you have this intersection. Good. I said I will skip this one. There are a couple, two more demos to go. Good, so I have cleaned up my data. I have done an in-depth durability analysis of my data. I've calculated damage, calculated fatigue lifetime. So now the next or final step is how to share these results with other teams. So the challenge that we see here typically is the traceability of the applied data processing methods and parameters. So we see with many customers that they do the processing of the data. They do a rainflow calculation, they calculate damage, PSD, and so on and so on. And if somebody would ask him the day after or the week after, yeah, how did you came to these results? Which SN curve did you apply? Which parameters did you use for the rainflow counting? Then most probably this test engineer can find this this spec. But if you would ask him in 1 month or half a year or a year, then it's most probably will become more difficult. A lot of companies need to follow specific ISO standards, so they need to prove, document how they came to specific result. So in many cases, the test engineer, what they do is they copy paste the processing parameter into a Word document, or they write it down. But that, of course, like you can imagine, takes quite some time to do that extra reporting. So how do we do that in TestLab? So let me go back to the data. So the process data, which are over here. Let me take one run. So let me take this channel, the first channel where I did a range pair counting expressed in damage. So which parameters did I use to come to this result? I simply look at the properties, and the properties of this channel, it's hidden by default, but when I look it up. So by default, TestLab automatically will add a property to each channel where it saves the parameters and the methods that were used to come to that specific result. So this channel, there you see that first of all, I did a range pair damage. For the range pair damage, I used a specific SN curve, and this SN curve had these parameters. Yeah? Before the range pair damage, I did a simple range pair, and before the range pair, I did a rainflow counting with these parameters. So this property, this creation history parameter, is a property which is automatically added to that specific channel. So if you copy your data, your project to another location or share it with other people, this property stays forever with that specific channel. So there is no need to manually make some kind of documentation on how you process the data. No, you can simply look inside the channel and see how this has been processed. So this saves you quite some time. We'll go back to the presentation for the last parts. So another challenge that we see when creating reports is that actually the time that the test engineers in spends in making nice fancy reports, he cannot spend in doing his actual work, which is doing tests. Eh? And on top of that, creating a report does not really add extra value to the measurement campaign. And secondly, the screenshots that you have inside these reports are typically copy pastes or screenshots from the acquisition or processing software. Yeah? So this is a bitmap. It does not contain any more information than what you see on the bitmap itself. Yeah? So whenever you share your report with another person, it is possible that the person says, yeah, okay, that graph looks nice, but can you please make a new graph, a new screenshot where you zoom in on a specific part? And I would like to see, yeah, what is the current value of that location? What is the min and max? So the test engineer then needs to go back to his acquisition software or processing software, open it up, make a new graph, copy paste it, and so on and so on. So that he loses a lot of time in making fancy reports. And that's also a question which I would like to ask you. So in your experience, in your daily work, how can you evaluate how much time do you spend on creating test reports? So if you look at the total activities, instrumentation, test setup, measure, validate, analysis, and report, how much time do you spend on creating these reports? Is it very little? It's not a lot of time. You say, yeah, it's quite a reasonable amount. Or in your eyes, I really spend too much time in making these reports. Couple of more seconds. Yeah, so here, as I expected, there are most of the people really say either a reasonable amount compared to the rest of the activities, and even almost half of the people say really too much. Yeah. Good. So there is a good news. Let's say SimCenter TestLab will help you with that. Again, here I will show you in a demo. Let me start from the load data analysis which I've just done. So I have here, let me enlarge a little bit. I have my results. So these are the rain flows, the range pair diagrams, and my calculated pseudo damage. So this is the graphs which I would like to have in my report. So for all channels like this, I also would like to have my level crossing, PSD, and so on. So how do I make a report? Let me select the first channel in the list, and I will click the report button here at the top. Now, I've already predefined the software to create a PowerPoint report. It could also be a Word document, and it appears here on the left of me. I will drag it into view. Here you have it. So now you see that automatically TestLab has created a PowerPoint document with the defined graphs, but for all channels. You see over here. But the nice thing is what appears to be a screenshot. So if I now double click on this screenshot, you will actually see that this screenshot is not a screenshot. It's actually the real graphs from TestLab. So what I can do is, for example, I can add a coupled cursor here. So I can work in these graphs as if I'm still working in TestLab. So as you can see at the top here, I'm still in PowerPoint, but I can add, for example, a legend like that, put the cursor. I can maybe say this curve is the one that's the biggest damage. So I put it in bold. I can go to the next graphs. Let's take this one over here, double click, and I can work on it. So the nice thing about this is that actually the person who received this report does not need to have TestLab installed on his PC. Yeah? There is a little add-in. It's a license free, which you need to have on your PC, but otherwise you can, there's nothing else that you need. You can just open PowerPoint, double click, and you can work on it as if you're still working in TestLab Neo. You can also, for example, copy the data like that, and then let me open Excel. If you prefer to further process or to look at the data in Excel, like that, and I paste my data over here, and then that starts with the metadata, and then here you have your actual values. Yeah. Good. Let me close this one and go back to the actual presentation. Good, to finish, two reference cases which I would like to share to you. Again, I do not have time to go into too much detail. The first reference case is from Nissan. Nissan, I think you all know. This is specifically from Nissan in Spain. And as you can see, they, besides using our SCADA 3 coder, they also bought our SimCenter TestLab software for both acquisition and analysis. And one of the challenges that Nissan had is actually to further optimize the durability behavior of one of their components, but in balance with the other performance attributes. And also they would like to get bigger insights or better insights, durability insights from the data that they collect. Yeah? And also here, if you look at the quote below, they say it's really easy to configure and also to allow us to automate our process. The other example is from the heavy equipment example, so very specific the agriculture. So AGCO, also I think you know, this one is from AGCO in Brazil. Also here, as you can see on the screenshot on the right, AGCO also has bought our SimCenter TestLab for doing both acquisition and processing. And there, their biggest achievements by using the SimCenter TestLab software is that actually they did the benchmark and they could reduce their load data analysis time from 1 day to, from 1 week to one day. Yeah. As also said on Wednesday, please refer to Kumar if you would like to have more information on these or other reference cases. We have a couple of reference cases. We are public, which we can share with publicly with other customers. So we will be very happy to share this with you in a private session. Good. So this is the end of the third session of the day. Quick reminder. So we have next week two other sessions, and the first session will be on Tuesday. where I will give you some more information on how to create a test schedule. And this not only for test benches and simulation. So I will explain to you how you can go from a real measured time signal on a public road, for example, and to create a accelerated shortened signal, but with containing still the same damage as the original signal. And also how I can create so-called customer correlated and optimized test schedules that can be used on proving grounds. Good, thank you for all staying awake. Thank you for attending this session. And with this, we can go to the Q&A session part of the webinar. Let me-
Thank you, Gert.
Thank you.
Can I request you to switch on your camera, and also Kumar, if you could come on screen. Sure. We have a couple of questions from some of our delegates.
Yep.
I'd like to take them one by one. There's a question on rotating component durability analysis looks complex. Any solution?
Yes, we do have a solution for that. Unfortunately, it would take me quite some while to explain that. We have as I said on Monday, and also I think on today, we always, that's a pity with these webinars and seminars, we have limited amount of time, and we kind of always need to pick out the topics that we'd like to present. We do have slides on doing durability on rotating components. I remember I forgot the name of the customer. I did one presentation in the past for a customer in India. So what I would like to propose is that I will share these slides after the session of today or next week with that specific customer.
Okay. Yep. Further, there's another question. Any AMC to be paid for test lab software regularly? AMC, annual maintenance contract. Is there an AMC to be paid for test lab software?
Maybe I can forward this question to Kumar.
Deepaksh. Maybe I prefer that I answer the participant directly. So I'll take up this question with him directly. Of course, there is a maintenance contract that is need to be paid, but that we can discuss the commercials and all later.
All right. Prashant Shukla wants to know, SimCenter can predict life of any motor? So can SimCenter predict life of any motor?
Any motor?
Yeah.
Of a motor, an engine?
Of a motor, yes.
Well, a lot of customers, they do durability testing on suspension, on body, and a couple also on battery packs now with the electric vehicles. On engine, on motors, not a lot of customers do. Of course, then with engine, we come back to the rotating components. So also there, unfortunately, I would like to refer to the slides that we will share after this meeting. I'm pretty sure maybe that the session on next week on Thursday with Ralph. Ralph is part of the engineering service department. I think he will be more suited to give more real life examples of this.
All right. So in fact, we had a question by Joy Chatterjee. He wanted to know what exactly is mean removal. And Ralph has actually already answered that in the Q&A platform, I can see. But as a follow-up to that answer, I think there's another question. It says, is TestLab a combined tool, data acquisition software and data analysis software? So is TestLab a combination of data acquisition and data analysis?
Yes. I tried to explain it, but apparently it was not so clear. Yes, indeed. So TestLab is a combination, is a single software platform that you can use for doing your test setup, defining all the parameters of your sensors, defining the measurement parameters, looking at the data, validating the data, and do the in-depth analysis of your data. It's a single software platform.
All right. Okay, so let me see if we have any question on our chat box. Okay, Satish Manocha wants to know, is is there any direct relationship between frequency and torque during fatigue testing?
Frequency and torque. Regarding frequency, so actually the two things. Frequency, as long as you stay in the elastic region, elastic behavior region of your component, frequency does not really have an influence on your number of cycles before it breaks. Yeah. Of course, and that's a thing that I come back to in the session on Tuesday. I've clearly said if you stay within the elastic region of your components. Of course, once you go a specific, if you go above a specific frequency, which is called the first natural frequency, then it is possible that you start to create extra vibrations in your component. Yeah? And then that is something that you need to or try to avoid when doing durability tests on components.
Okay. So we have another question. This is from Joseph M. He wants to know, we want to calculate life of the component under FRF 33 Hertz and under RLDMS with temperature and pressure as additional cyclic loads for cycles to failure. Whether it is possible for combination of load vibration, pressure and thermal cycle load in one stretch.
My immediate answer would be yes. It, of course, it will not be as easy as a simple fatigue analysis. Let me think. If that's okay, I also would like to take that question offline and answer it afterwards.
Sure. So Joseph, if you're still online, Gert would take your question and answer it in details once the series ends, right? Okay, so one question from Kishore Katare, he wants to know, what type of damage is accurate, strain or vibration?
What type of damage is accurate? I don't actually understand the question.
So Kishore, can you please rephrase your question and send it to us? I would then pass it on to Gert. Meanwhile, Ravi Kumar Shinde wants to know, is the software available for trial or student version for learning purpose?
Yeah, I think also Kumar.
Yes, Dipanshu. I'm responding to him and I'm sharing a link.
Okay.
So that has more details around that. So.
All right. So Ravi, you can please check your Q&A box. You will receive an answer from Kumar on your question. All right. I'm still waiting for any more questions. If you have any more questions, we can possibly take one more. And Kishore Katare, if you're still around, you can possibly
The question from Kishore Gert is, one, can the damage be calculated using vibration measurement also, like we do for strain? If yes, then is strain-based calculations are accurate or vibration-based?
Yeah, and that's also something I will touch upon in the session next week. Is the difference between doing durability testing on, let's say, on subcompone on vehicles on larger subsystems or on individual components. For the thing that I explained up to now is what we call low frequency testing. So typically you measure up to 1 kilohertz because you trying to find out or measure loads at a frequency up to 100 hertz. But for component testing, there you test in the higher frequency range. So that's something I touch upon a little bit on the session on Tuesday.
All right, gentlemen, I think those were the questions that we have from our delegates today. Thank you so much, everyone, for participating in this third session on our series on durability testing. Please do remember that we are going to be back for two more sessions next week. One is scheduled on the 10th of August and the final session, wherein we will have Rolf Lies coming in as our expert for the session on the 12th of August. So thank you once again, gentlemen. Thank you, Gert. Thank you, Kumar. for this session today. See you next week.
Thank you so much. Have a nice weekend, everyone. Thank you.
Thank you. Have a nice weekend. Bye-bye.